Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Well, I'm lucky in a way because Vipul spoke just before me. I was apprehensive that the post-class sessions normally are negotiated terms the day session. And that's one. Second, and my talk is going to be a little bit on the academic side. I won't be talking much about the Kushboo Gujarat campaign for the simple reason that from what I was going to understand about TED and the literature that was sent to me is about the ideas. So, essentially, we're talking about what I think about this is describing in the box of. Describing the government for some time, fortunately, happened to work in the tourism sphere and developed a kind of a passion for tourism. So I will actually essentially be talking about what I think tourism should be, how the way it is going, and give you a parting thought, probably can do you some good. I take the liberty to read up this slide, and despite the fact that I was said not to be reading. Since we are all in Pune, there was this gentleman named Mr. D.D. Kosambi, a very great mathematician that subsequently turned into a historian. He has quoted something which is of relevance to us. He, in one of his writings, he said that the great Eastern trade route went through north from Rajki to the Ganges, which is crossed above Patna. There was a branch in opposite direction to Gaya. Beyond the river, it went to Vaisali, the headquarters of the Rishis. Then on to Nepal, there is somewhere near the Rumindey pillar of the slope that marks the Buddha's birthplace. Hence, the route swung west to the capital, Savasti, of the leading kingdom of Kosala, and so to the Delhi Mathura region. The farm of the trade across Punjab was Taksila. One important branch must have gone south, perhaps from Savasti to through Kosambi to Ujjain, which was the logical center of diffusion of small trade in the white tribal south. Why I chose to put this slide and I didn't take the pain memorizing, I'm very good at memorizing large extracts of notes, I would say that even this text is, it dates back to maybe 2000 years, that's when Ashoka and Buddha was there. But it is of relevance to us today also, because if you want to explore India, I see no other activity which could be as interesting. Travel is a phenomenon as well as mankind itself. You see, traditionally we have been traveling, you see, ancient times, the stories, the history. It's either for, on a pilgrimage, for trade, for conquest. That was how old ages it has developed. As time passed by now, the nature of travel has changed, the number of people traveling has changed. As you come down to history, we have the Industrial Revolution that took place due to the Industrial Revolution. You have the invention of the steam engine, which of course became a precursor, or became the trigger for mass travel. I'll just show you a slide which comes next. Unfortunately, since the lights on, it's not too clear. Now this actually is a painting which was, which is in a museum in Essen, Germany. Dates back to 1875, and we have a family which is pouring over the map. The painting is known as Travel Plans. Essentially, what I'm trying to depict is the importance of travel over ages as it changes. Once we have the Industrial Revolution coming in, travel is taken the form of leisure because this Industrial Revolution, we have disposable incomes, we have prosperity coming in, and travel slowly, the nature of travel changes. So, this we come to something known as mass tourism. See, after 1875, we come down 75 years hence, in the mid-50s, 1950s, we have people traveling in large numbers. Now, these large numbers are essentially because the modes of travel, you have a number of them. We have steam engines, we have the jet engine, which was invented in 1950. And essentially, travel took off from the Industrial Revolution. I would say it was because of the Industrial Revolution that we had travel happening. Because once in the Industrial Revolution happened, we have the disposable incomes and we have people have leisure time, we have shorter working hours, and we're traveling. But then, since a lot of you have a management background and study management, people apart from engineering background, we know that the industry model in which we are working has given us diminishing returns. I would probably not elucidate on that because of the possibility of climate policy. This model is what is happening to tourism as we see it today. To give you a picture of what is happening in the world in terms of mass travel, the mass movements of people across various settings. International tourist growth, like you see, it was 4.6%. You see the numbers. And 2011 was 93 million. And the receipts which we got, and it was estimated in our estimates, is about 1,030 billion US dollars. Now you have to understand that post industrial revolution, this is the next revolution that has happened in the travel industry. Of course, the service sector is doing very well. But within the service sector, there is a travel segment which has been progressing leaps and bounds. So it's very important to know that travel is such a tourist, the tourism industry is such an important sphere in the economic activities that, that are taking place today. If you see India, 2011 we had about 8508 lakhs of tourists coming in, growth rate of 12.21, about 12%. Since I happen to be working in Gujarat at this point in time, I would say that even Gujarat, the tourist growth rates are one of the tourists. In fact, the highest in the country last year alone was about 18%. Again, emphasizing the fact that how important travel is and how it is increasing by leaps and bounds, the economic activity associated with travel. Okay. This is mass tourism. Now, what was industrial revolution all about? Where is it going next? I would firstly say that it's about consumption. Consumption, consumption, and consumption. As a natural corollary, tourism also being a spin-off of industry revolution, it's about consumption. In case you're traveling somewhere, you would take a simple example of yourself. If you're in Pune, you go down to Mumbai on the weekends, what do? You're consuming, right from the point you start from here. Consuming in terms of the vehicles, you go, you reach Mumbai, meet a weekend, and like the previous speaker, Mr. Vipul, was saying, probably party, depending on your inclinations, your kind of choices. So it's consumption, consumption, and consumption. In that context, I would refer to what René Descartes said, he was a mathematician from France. He said, for ego and ego sum, I think, therefore I am. But somehow, I prefer to say, in the current context, it should be that consumption of ego sum, I consume, therefore I am. And this would be very apt for the tourism that is happening today. Of course, it's a larger picture, it's in a larger context, as I go ahead in my talk, I'll be explaining, trying to explain a bit. The biggest challenge that tourism is facing in the current times is the challenge due to the mass movement of people. What is tourism as we see it? It is essentially you travel from spot A to spot B. Spot B is probably some good location which pleases your eyes. You go, see, spend some time, spend money, and come back. This is what we talk about. This is what tourism is about. You have vacations, you probably take a package tour to much of the places, mainly Southeast Asia, like you were saying, Bangkok, or Europe, or nearer home, one of the stations like Mathura, Akhandala, Lonavala, Malchit, or whatever. This is mass travel. We go there, again come back. I very strongly feel that this kind of an approach, this is doing real damage to the ecosystem that we live in. Now, what I personally feel, this was what I said before, theories. I very strongly feel that our want to celebrate the small that is beautiful and the local that is glorious. I very strongly believe in this. Now, this approach has been kind of wonders not only for the destination but also for the environment and ecology. Destination comes second in this approach. When I say the small that is beautiful and local that is glorious, I would mean take small joys. I would want to experience joys by going to local places, going to maybe just next to going to say Lonavala, but then not just going there and coming back after spending some time just traveling. But want to go there, experience the local context, what the people do there, entwine with them, That is what I mean by saying the local. Now, how this approach of tourism can be explained to you? In tourism theories, any destination, surprisingly, even the field of tourism has lots of papers written on it, lots of theories, and so none of the theories, just as you are studying in your curriculum. The tourism destination also goes in development cycle. You know, first destination is discovered, then naturally, once it's discovered, it grows. Then what happens is it consolidates. Then it stagnates. I'll give you an example. Probably could relate better with an example. Let's take the case of a hill station like Nanita. Class. I was able to understand that there are lots of students here who are probably from our country and different parts of the country. Nanita, when it was discovered way back in British times, it was a beautiful place to be in. Of course, I'm not that old, but I could have experiences, but then that's what old timers say, and that's what was written about Nanita. That was a discovery. People started coming in, and what happens? It grows. Naturally, people see an opportunity in this destination. Grows and consolidates. What happens next? Stagnates and starts to deteriorate. This is what is true with all the stations. Since I spoke about Nanita, I have mentioned this more of the stations. I said stagnating and deteriorating, it is, you go to any station, how would you see the concrete jungle? But in the first place, why would you go to the station? It was not to see a concrete jungle. It was to experience something, is it not? That is what is development cycle. And what we are trying to do, what I would say is that I think about this, I feel about this very passionately. This is a model which I'm trying to work in the place where I'm currently hosted. And the place where the Kushboo campaign is currently on. In fact, the Kushboo term also, it got associated with the Kushboo Gujarat because you're relating to the ground, you're relating to something which is sublime and very sublime, which is with the place, the nature, the type of the place. Again, theories. I think after that very hale and happy and lively talk, my beautiful, it should be a soothing effect. Yeah. The old paradigm in tourism talks about, I would not say it's old paradigm, it's the current paradigm in which tourism works. It talks about profit as a motive, it talks about products, it talks about position, the branding. In fact, branding and talk of branding, I would say the branding is for that reason now, it's not branding. Price is a push. I don't want to think, that's how to say, not I, but then this is how we're working. Instead of a business profit, I would say the purpose. Why does a destination exist? It should be for purpose. Profit should not be what is driving traffic there. See, again, look back to the model, remember I said, if it's profit purely, it goes to the cycle and then it deteriorates. If there's a purpose for people to visit a destination, a purpose in terms of, again, it's a subliminal thing, purpose, drawing people there so that they experience the character of the place. That's the purpose. Instead of product, in fact, even when I talk to my travel operators, etc., unknowingly or knowingly, talk about the destination as a product. That's the marketing jargon, and probably it seems fashionable, unfortunately. It should be seen more as a place as a character. And that is what we should be talking about. That is how it should develop. A product basis is, okay, let's think of it as a product. A product has a natural life cycle. Amazon is gone, the product is over. So, it should be identified as a place. In fact, the next one, the position planning, place is a personality. Overlap, concept overlaps. Price. Instead of the price, what you book a place, you have a price for that. Instead of that, what is the value? What value do you have for that place? This again is very intrinsic to the place. And last but not least is the push. Who pushes you to a destination? It's the marketing which happens for a destination. For example, be it Gujarat, or be it Mauritius, or be it the Southeast Asia. They're constantly bombarded by marketing campaigns. And that can take over with people who sell the product. So instead of that push, there should be a pull. the next slides, I also see talk about what kind of pull can happen. Like I said, a focus on developing activities and practices rather than metros and products. Here again, we are talking about something which is very, very entwined in the character of the place. The whole model revolves around the people who live there. We bring in tourists to experience the place, so that the spin-offs of the local people's locals only. Now what happens is, any modern tourism, they're pushing people. For example, again, I think local example, so Lonavala. How do you go? Who takes you there? You have some operator from here taking you there. You have some hotels there. Probably, no property is not being put up by local person. People are coming from outside. So, the spin-offs with local people don't actually happen. So, what we are talking about is, we talk about activities and practices so that things are run by local people only. We talk about the hub and spoke model also, whether the hub is where a tourist lands. Again, start giving examples of Lonavala because probably all of us can associate better because we are here. This is a hub, Pune. Now, you need to go to different places. You have Lonavala, you have Marche, you have Shirdi. These can be the spokes. Spokes, again, these are distinct, but not in the traditional sense. You go to Lonavala, you have an experience. You talk to the local people, you get an experience there, you stay with them, you enjoy their culture, you enjoy their cuisine. And this is what we're trying to drive at. In the process, we also see what you're seeing now. But the difference is, it's the local person who has a stake, he develops it. Since he develops it, since he or she has a stake, they are bound to maintain the place. So the place does not deteriorate. Now, we are actually working on this model where I'm there. There are two or three destinations which we are implementing. And what we have done is, we are using innovative crowdsourcing technologies because it's not crowd-driven. Whatever ideas come in, it's the stakeholders. We talk to them, it's inputs from them. Because ultimately what happens is when you have a stakeholder who is associated with the project, it's very natural that they own it. So this is the real-time monitoring also takes place, and online marketing takes place with the locals only. We cannot drive it. We just drive it from the top. We actually cannot operationalize it. So that's the best part of this model. And essentially talk about creating a holistic place for people to live in and for people to visit. The whole model is driven by people who are living there. It's not the people who are visiting that place. So you are drawing people to the destinations. Another concept which we are working on is very successfully, which I very strongly feel about this is, you go to any tourist spot, you have souvenirs. It's very surprising when you go to the Gate of India, you have souvenirs from Kashmir also, which is very interesting. And we buy it, so that's also very interesting. We have never actually thought of something which is very local, was this in India. But that's how things are. What we are doing is, we are making souvenirs and it's being tagged. The souvenir has a tagline, a storyline with it. Once a person buys a souvenir, there's a complete story which goes on in the souvenir. And the traffic gets driven to that place because of the storyline. Assuming you have some local handicraft of, say, Lonavala, sold somewhere in Mumbai, it's got this tagline with it, a story attached to it. The tourist gets back to that, through that story, contacts the local community who actually manufactures that product, the souvenir. What happens is once they reach here, once they reach Lonavala, it's then the community takes over the complete travel of them. The traveling of those people, the stay of those people, if they need guides, inspectors, the whole hog is taken care of the community. So what I'm trying to again drive at is, we are involving the local communities. Again, in the whole process, you are sustaining a destination. It's all about sustaining a destination because the way I talked about the industry of revolution before and the diminishing values, so tourism also is not going to be the same way. This is what I was mentioning. Theory is very good. It's very easy to give lectures on this kind. And it sounds very idealistic and very nice. This is how it should be. But it doesn't happen in this way. It's very challenging. And the biggest challenges that we face is the question happens to be, I'm not even, why should I get into all this? At the end of the day, why do you do an economic activity? That's the Kamara. But That's a very short-sighted view. That's our biggest challenge. And the process of unlearning, because since all of you are the younger generation, probably if some thoughts could have got triggered, because ultimately at the end of the day, what are we here for? Life is indeed beautiful, and it's also famous and very fragile. These things, as you grow older in life, you realize that you need to sustain things. If you don't work in a sustainable model, you're doing great injustice to yourselves, as well as most of them are not married or engaged also, but then the future generations that would come in. So this is a model on which we are trying to work very vigorously. It's very different from the Kushboo campaign which you see on the TV screens, because in itself was a very interesting process. In fact, we'll be launching a new series of films maybe just in a couple of weeks. Those films again feature Mr. Bachchan. He's talked about this. In fact, there are two films which talk about integrating handicrafts, global cuisines, and the twist that we have given to those films is it goes back to sustainability. So, with this push from the government side, we hope that this message goes across. And well, that's all I can say. I won't be saying much, but then probably some kind of a trigger or spark has come into you. It could be a success on our side, because we know it. You know, see what is happening. You talk about things like climate change, depletion of resources. Why is all that happening? Because it's a rampant abuse of the natural resources. This, at the end of the day, is all about sustainability and conserving our resources. Or it's all over in no time. Thank you.